How good are you in bed? As
me,
a pilot.
Me, oh, well, okay. Like I say, I think you'd have to, you can't answer that for yourself. You'd have to ask, those who have participated with me. I haven't received any complaints.
You haven't received any complaints.
That's good. Then again, pilots are very narcissistic, so they probably wouldn't listen anyway. But I think so far so good. It's.
I beg your pardon.
Hey, my besties, it's your favorite caffeinated, medicated, and never hydrated nurse. It's Nurse John, and welcome back to your favorite podcast. I beg your pardon, bestie, another week, another podcast, another therapy session, and another guest. I know you guys are super excited to know who the guest is for today's podcast, but before that, do me a quick favor and make sure that you download this episode. Make sure that you share it. Make sure that you follow us on Apple and Spotify podcasts. And make sure that you tag me on Instagram and the guests that you will be seeing and knowing today. And also, if you're wondering what kind of scrubs I wear in the hospital, it's Gardemalade, G-R-D-E-M-A-L-A-D-E. And if you want a discount code, you can use my discount code NurseJohn, G-M, N-U-R-S-E-J-O-H-N-G-M. Now, I know you guys are super excited to get to know the podcast guest for this week. Well, I think we're going to crack it with an announcement. Can we do that? Do you think we can do that?
Sure, why not?
Okay, amazing. So your captain today will be giving an announcement shortly.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is your captain speaking. Could you please make sure that your trays are stowed and your seats are in the upright position? Because we will be taking off shortly for an interview with Nurse John.
Thank you so much. Well, guess what, you guys? We have a pilot in our podcast. Hello, Skid.
Hello, Johnny.
Thank you so much for coming and accepting this invitation to be on my podcast.
My pleasure, absolutely.
And thank you to your daughter, who referred you to me.
Shout out to Janelle.
Janelle.
And all the nurse students at Red River College in Winnipeg, Manitoba, Canada, who are watching right now, losing their minds. Hi.
Hello, Janelle. Thank you so much for referring your dad. Let me just give you guys a little backstory. So I was looking for a pilot for the piece of nursing, the red flags of nursing. And Janelle messaged me directly to tell me, hey, Nurse John, my dad is a pilot and he is also in social media, doing videos, doing all of this. I think he will be the perfect guest for you. So I spoke to her and I was like, listen, Janelle, connect me with your dad. I would love to have your dad in my podcast. And Skid made it here all the way in Los Angeles, California.
Just a couple Canadian boys down here make it in Hollywood.
Exactly. And thank you, because I mean, like, you have some works to do here in California, but again, you came in a day early just to be here on the podcast.
Well, thanks for that intro. Just in terms of shout outs. First of all, shout outs to the other two daughters, Claire and Ariane. Good to see you guys too.
Hey, Claire and Ariane.
And then the big shout out, of course, National Test Pilot School. Those are the guys that I work for down here who allowed me to come down a day early and do this stuff and make this happen. So thanks, JB. But then really, the people who really make that run, Tammy, Maria, Diane, Bree, and Josh. Over to you guys.
Guys, thank you so much for sending Skid here, because you know what? The people are waiting for a pilot, you know, episode, and you guys made it happen for Skid to be here. So thank you so much. Shout out to National Test Pilot School in Mojave, California. Shout out to you guys. Thank you again. So Skid, since we're here, let's get to know you better. We want to know more about our favorite pilot right now.
Where would you like to start? Right at the very beginning, I suppose?
Right at the beginning. Let's do it.
Well, you probably want to know when the first time that I actually thought that I wanted to be a pilot was.
That is true. Was it an influence? Like, tell us more about you growing up.
So my dad was a military pilot. So the apple doesn't fall far from the tree, mm-hmm. obviously. I remember being 4 years old. And remember, I was born in 68. So when I was 4 years old, it was 1972. It was a different world back then. My mother was pregnant with my brother at the time, and they were sending me off to go stay with my grandparents for a little bit so that they could take care of my mother giving birth and all that.
Right.
So they used to have military transport on the old DC-3. So 4-year-old Skid, Brian at the time, just goes on the plane by himself, and they take me to where my grandparents were and drop me off with them. And that was it, because that's how we used to roll back then. And it was great. Anyway, the point is that I remember definitely being 4 years old and looking out the window. And as we lift off from the ground, and I'm like pushing on the floor of the plane going, why is this in the air? And I knew this is what I want to do.
That is so cool. At 4 years old, that's like the coolest thing you could ever tell your playmates. Like, mm-hmm. I rode a freaking airplane.
Absolutely.
That's crazy. And was this all in Canada?
Yeah. So my dad was in the Canadian Forces, and we moved around with him for quite some time. And he took us flying a couple times because we were allowed to do familiarization flights with the family every once in a while. And so I did that. I flew with him a few times. And being in that environment and growing up that way, yeah, I always wanted to do some flying.
That's amazing. And I guess your parents were supportive enough to let you do it.
Well, it turns out, though, I didn't start that way. I had always wanted to be an astronaut. So I went into physics to start with. So I did my first degree in physics.
Wow.
And then okay, I actually...
We got a smart brain in here.
Oh, wait for it. I was actually doing PhD stuff down in University of Colorado at Boulder in space science.
Okay.
But as that was going on, I got the bug. I said, no, I gotta get back to this flying stuff. So I put in my application to join the military at that time. And it took a long time for it to happen because this was like 1991. So Berlin Wall had come down, budgets are coming down, all this stuff. So it took a while to get in. But I finally got in. And although there was some more weight in the training, so I picked up another master's in aerospace engineering. And wow. Then finally got to go fly. And then sure enough, I was flying jets eventually.
So you were an engineer first.
I was a physics guy first and then an engineer later.
And then a pilot.
All at the same time. Yeah.
Wow. Skid. You got everything. Brains.
Sure, yeah.
Well, you were doing all of this. Were you dating? Like, what's the situation? Like, were you a nerdy guy or were you the jock? Like, what's going on in here?
So, lots of dating.
Lots of dating, okay.
And maybe you can show that picture of me back from 1996. Definitely while I was in flight school, lots of dating going on.
You're a good-looking man.
Well, thanks, Johnny.
So, like, I hope the daughters would agree. Do we agree, girls? Yeah. Dad looks good. How old are you, Skid? Because you said...
55.
55. Mm. We don't look 55, Skid.
Well, thank you.
And we're going to crack it right here. Are you single? Are you married? Because you have kids.
I do. 3 kids. I am divorced for quite some time. Gosh, like almost 20 years. And yeah, I'm single.
The nurse is listening right now. We got a single dad here who is also a very smart guy. Good looking. And he's got everything. And you know how many nurses... are single?
Quite a few, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Have you dated any nurses?
I did date a nurse at one point way back when.
Whoa. See, confirmation, guys. First confirmation, pilots do date nurses. What is it with nurses that made you attracted to them?
So I didn't date her just because she was a nurse.
It was just so happened?
Because she was who she was. But what I did tend to notice about nurses, they tend to be very giving. So that's nice.
Oof. That's the part that we hate the most, is we give way too much. Any nurse in your family?
Medical field type stuff, but not a nurse, no.
Not a nurse.
Other than daughter Janelle, of course, studying right now.
Janelle, good luck, girl. You got this. You're going to be an amazing nurse. Remember the video. Not just remember the videos, but the videos hopefully inspires you instead of scare you to the profession. But good luck to you, Janelle. But okay, so you were dating a lot during this time.
Enough, less than some, more than most, yeah.
This profession of yours as a pilot, when did you become a pilot? Because it's hard, because for us people who doesn't know about being a pilot, all we know is it's expensive.
So it can be. So I joined the military to get my training. However, before I did, I picked up what's called a private pilot license. And a private pilot license is what allows you to go rent an airplane and fly it around legally.
Okay.
So when you're a private pilot, well, it means is you can take your plane, but you can't do anything for compensation. You can't hire yourself out as a pilot, but you can fly around. So I got my private pilot license just to see if I could fly and see if I liked it. Because before you make that kind of time commitment, you should probably know if that's something that you want to do.
Right.
Because as I talked about history-wise, I thought I did, but let's see what happens. Anyway, I went and did it, and I loved it, was good at it, and I said, definitely. And that's when I put my application in the military. So going into doing all the military training, of course, doesn't cost any money. It costs time, though, and commitment.
For sure.
At the time when I went and got my wings, which is the equivalent of having your commercial pilot license on the civilian side, that was you owed 5 years of time after that. Nowadays, it's 7.
Okay, so it got longer to become a pilot. Is that what you're saying?
Well, what it means is they want that back from you. Since they put that kind of money and time into training you, right, they want at least that much back in commitment.
Wow. Because I have a few friends, actually, who's in flight school, and all I know is they got the money for them to be able to be there.
Yeah.
Because it's really not like a regular thing that you just go to. Like, you don't just go to a university and say like, oh, I'll be a pilot here in the university, you know? Like, it's such a specific course and profession and school for you to even think about going to one.
Definitely. If there's some flight colleges around me, and we're talking about Canada at this point,
right,
and so it's similar in the States here, but there's some flight colleges that you can go to which will teach you more than just the flying, the administration of flying programs, stuff like that. But they're all very expensive. Is there scholarships? Sure. But doing flying on your own to get there is very, very pricey proposition and takes time.
Were you scared thinking about, like, you know, because for me still, like, I don't understand how a huge machine can just fly up in the air like that and be flown by just one or two people. For me, it still doesn't make sense. And again, I'm just speaking here in a very, like, general opinion. Just like for big ships, like, I don't understand how it floats in the water. And there's thousands of people in it, plus the equipments and stuff, and all the luggages for, like, airplanes. Like, how? Can you give us a little bit of explanation in this? First of all, were you scared getting into this career?
I would say that when you're starting off, what you're more scared of is screwing up.
That's
you,
it.
You don't.
For sure.
And it must be similar in nursing when you put yourself in pressure situations as you're learning stuff and then you have to do it. I mean, you don't want to screw something up, A, for the patient, but in front of your peers or anything like that. So
that's it.
It's the same kind of thing when you're doing flight training. You don't want to fail a flight. You don't want to look dumb. You want to bring your A game. Chuck Yeager used to say you don't want to screw the pooch. And so you put a lot of time and effort into making sure that you do your stuff correctly. Was I afraid of dying or anything like that? No, there wasn't any time. You're so busy studying and flying and doing your stuff that that doesn't really become part of it. As to, you know, your other question, I flew F-18s at one point, and that's a $30 million aircraft that can do all kinds of interesting stuff. And so how can one guy fly that? Training. How does a nurse get really good at doing ER stuff? How does anybody get good at doing anything really, really hard that requires a lot of study? Practice and hard work.
Right. Because if you think about it, for me, like, though I'm responsible of someone's life, I can always choose how many people I'm responsible with. Or it's not always the same amount of people. But for you guys, sometimes it's like, if it's a full plane, you know, you have, I don't know, 300 or 200 people in your hands. And you guys are responsible for that. And for people to trust you.
I would say that at some point, every good pilot has some kind of narcissistic thing where he thinks that he is the greatest and he can make it happen. And it sounds funny to say it that way, and it seemed kind of bad. But on the other hand, you need a little bit of that.
For sure.
As the confidence that takes you into that situation is that, yeah, I've got 200 people in my hands. Yeah, I'm good with that because I know that I'm exactly the guy that I want to be here.
Like, you know what?
That's just the way you have to think. And if you don't do that, then you shouldn't be in that cockpit.
I like that. I like that thinking too, because, like, you have to believe in yourself, first of all, for you to be able to, like, believe that you can actually fly this.
Well, it must be similar in high pressure nursing situations.
Oh, for sure. Yeah. For sure. Exactly. But for us, it takes so much time, though. Just, like, for sure with you guys, it takes so much time and experience for me to even believe that I'm capable of healing someone. And though, for me though, for us nurses, is we're never going to be 100% comfortable in ourselves. That's just what nursing is, because once we get too comfortable, that's when mistakes happens for us. You have to always be open and learning and making sure that you're expanding your knowledge and, you know, being curious and whatnot. Because for us, it's kind of different, because like you said, for pilots, you kind of have to have that kind of like narcissistic kind of like, I'm the best pilot and I know I can fly this plane and take these people to wherever they're going to go. But in nursing, I am that nurse. But at the same time, I don't trust everything that I believe in. I still have to ask someone just to make sure that what I'm doing is right. Because at the end of the day, for us, it's a multidisciplinary kind of approach.
Right.
Compared to, which I'm not sure, but for you guys, it's multidisciplinary too, I think, because you are two people flying a plane, or sometimes one, but you're still working with other people inside the plane. So I think it's a whole thing.
So in terms of multidisciplinary thing, well, you think about it, first of all, you kind of have two questions there. One's the subject matter and the other is the crew that you work with. So subject matter wise, yeah, pilots got to know the aerodynamics. They got to know the regulations. They got to know how the rules of the road works in the air. They got to know different types of physics with the icing, with the different weather. You have to be a master of weather with all kinds of stuff. There's a lot of considerations that go into every single flight that have to be taken into account before we even start turning an engine. In terms of actual, we call it crew resource management, I did a lot of single pilot flying, not only for the military, but also for the RCMP. And even that you're just the only person in the cockpit, there's still the resource management of the different systems in the cockpit. There's air traffic control, there's the ground handlers, there's all of the people involved with ops. So if you're going to do any kind of flying, it's actually managing an entire team around that effort. So there's a lot more to it than just the guy or guys in the cockpit.
That's really good to know, because again, like, we're thinking that it's just a pilot.
It's like anything else. Like you mentioned with the nurses, though, the entire team. There is an entire team at work. And when you look at the infrastructure, like I flew into Burbank today, like just in the back of the airplane, obviously, the amount of infrastructure that's in place to make sure that like people don't realize how dangerous flying is, and yet how unbelievably safe it is because of the amount of work and the margins that go into making everything safe. Like flying into Burbank here today was way safer than the drive here, because driving is two orders of magnitude more risky than flying. And why is that? It's because flying has so much that goes into making everything airworthy. And so when people are thinking about it, yeah, there is, think of your air traffic control. Think of the people who maintain the runways. Think of the people who are doing all the standards and stuff. There's a lot that goes into it that makes sure that your flying is really, really safe. You've been seeing things in the news, oh, this problem happened with this airplane stuff. Yeah, but there was 100,000 other flights that went perfectly. Think right. of the statistics.
Right. That's so funny too, because I mean, like, that's media anyways. They only highlight the bads. So then it scares people out and then it becomes a whole thing, but they don't realize. Just like in nursing too, one person had a bad experience with one nurse or one doctor, and for them, every single nurses are the same, or every single doctor is the same. It's just like, you cannot compare one apple to another apple and say that we all are going to be the same. Just like what you're explaining, that not one bad experience in an airplane will be the same as to every single other airplane.
Of course, you're absolutely right in your analysis of the media. Like they say, if it bleeds, it leads, right? So,
right.
You know, they're only ever going to report the bad stuff.
That's right. That's right. So going back to you being a pilot in pilot school, was there any time you think like, was this really for me, or were you just persevere to become one?
From time to time. I mean, I think like anybody going through something hard, like your nursing students, when the workload becomes really high and you haven't had a lot of sleep, there's a lot of pressure.
For sure.
Maybe something isn't going quite right. You know, there's other stuff going on, and you think to yourself, man, this is taking a lot of work, right? Because, you know, the people who end up doing these kind of things, I mean, if you're going to be a nurse, you're an above average person. You're dedicating yourself to something bigger. You got to bring some smarts to that. You got to bring some ability to that. That's kind of a calling, right? And it's so similar thing with aviation. And so you go through high school, maybe, well, that was kind of easy. And now you're actually doing something hard. Sure. And it's not, and you're just like, oh, I used to sail through stuff. I'm not sailing through this anymore. That's because you're actually challenging yourself. So challenging yourself is something that is going to hurt at some point. Otherwise, it's not going to be a challenge. And so at some point, you got to reach down and deal with that. So do you feel low at times? Absolutely. It wouldn't have been a worthwhile thing to do if you didn't feel low and you had to conquer that somehow.
I like that. I like that analogy because that's true. Like, nothing good comes easy.
No.
Basically. And, you know, at the end, it's going to be so worth it when you know that you struggle with it and you survive it. And you're like, you know what? I did all of that for something.
Absolutely.
And that's kind of like, it's the same thing in nursing. Because I feel like, again, in this generation that we have right now, I feel like things comes easy. And people don't realize that, you know, you got to put hard work and a lot of patience, a lot of energy, a lot of time for you to get where you want to be. But then again, it's the media and the things that's being shown to us that, you know, you can get things easier right now, but that's not how it should be, because then we get wired to think that things can just pop up in front of you and everything is okay.
You're going to start dragging me into a political conversation here, but to keep it as small as possible, and I feel I can talk about this because I've brought three children through the modern education system. And I've been just watching it get worse and worse and worse with every daughter that goes through. And part of it, what you're talking about, is that as opposed to putting a scholastic program together, which has definite standards, it seems to be more of an emphasis on how you feel about what happens, what we would call the participation trophy thing. And it's okay to, you know, it shouldn't be zero. You should respect people's feelings and take care of things. And, you know, you need a good emotional environment to learn in. I get that. But at the same time, if you're going to completely get rid of standards whatsoever, life won't. And so you might just do fine and coast through everything because no one's ever told you did anything wrong. But then you encounter something in the real world, like you're talking about, well, you're nursing, you know, there are consequences to things not working. If that's the first time that you found that instead of in school, you're in for a huge shock. And I feel that we've done a super disservice to our latest generations because we haven't prepared them for that real life stuff like we should have in school.
That's it. And again, like, sometimes I feel like school is just so unrealistic with what they teach. And again, I'm not shitting on our education because we have one of the best educations that we can get in terms of like where we live, which is a first world country compared to the others. But then the teachings are just not preparing kids and new generation to what really is the harsh reality that we are facing right now in the real world.
Yeah, absolutely. And like I say, we won't get too political, but
for
the kids out there, if there isn't a possibility of failure, if there isn't a possibility that the whole thing could just go completely south, you're not working hard enough.
That's it. That's it. For me too. It's when I feel comfortable, I know there's something is wrong.
Good point.
Once you feel comfortable in your life and nothing is stressing you out and things are just flowing easily, you're doing something wrong.
You know, that's a really interesting point too, because I'm working into being an instructor now. And it's important as an instructor to know that when you get really comfortable doing something, it's like, that's because you know everything. You're like Alex Trebek with all the answers in front of you.
Right.
If you don't have the answers, it's a lot more stressful. And so the instructor always has to try and put themselves in the student's frame of mind. It's like, you know, this is kind of hard. And so when you get that level of comfort, you should be a good instructor should find things that they don't know how to do and go do them so they remember what their students feel like.
That's it. That's it. Grounding yourself. That's why, because you just mentioned you're planning to become an instructor. I'm an instructor right now. I just left bedside and I'm now a nursing clinical instructor for nursing students because I felt like when I was a student and I had instructor, not every single instructor, but I feel like my instructor could have done better, prepared me to what is the real world when it comes to nursing. So then I told myself, you know what, maybe I can be an instructor and I can prepare new generations of nurses getting into the workforce and tell them the truth, tell them what it is actually is like to be a nurse. Just like I'm pretty sure that's what your goal is too in becoming an instructor, is because you've had so much experience flying and being a pilot and you want this new generations to have what it takes to be one and to be able to fly aircrafts.
I think it's also just a natural evolution of being human. You spend 30 years getting really good at doing something. And you get towards the end of your career, you know,
right.
And it's not like I can still fly and stuff, but I'm 55 and I don't feel like putting in 12-hour days anymore. I just can't do that anymore.
Right.
So what do you do with 30 years of skill? Well, pass it on to somebody else. That is, so it's a natural thing to become tribal elder. I'm not a warrior anymore. More of a tribal elder now because I'm a mentor. And that's what you should be taking with that skill to pass it on. So I feel that's the important thing. And there's other stuff, like you said, that go along with it. But at the end of the day, I wouldn't pass on to somebody how I feel politically necessarily, but mm-hmm. I would pass on the skills. And then if they asked me, I'd tell them.
I love that. So just going back here, because I just remember you said you were raising 3 kids. You were raising them alone.
Yep.
While being a pilot, while doing all this stuff. Were you a pilot then when you were raising these kids, or were you on your way to become a pilot?
Definitely in the middle of being a pilot for the Canadian Forces. When the whole stuff started cooking along, when the situation changed, I took a ground job working in headquarters for quite some time so that I could be around more.
Yeah.
Still working full time, but working in one place at one time, just doing one thing. It wasn't until the kids were a little bit older that I started getting back into flying again. But that was flying that wasn't like flying fighters anymore. I was doing something that had me home every night. And so that was fun.
So you can be with the kids.
Absolutely.
Man, the nurses right now are hearing this. They're like, okay, we got an all around in here. We got a jack of all trades in here. So how was that racing? And they're all girls, right?
Yep.
All girls.
Yep.
Being raised by one single dad. How did that go? Because it's, first of all, you're raising girls. Girls, yes, are hard to raise.
Well,
in a way that, you know, you've got to be protective with these girls, and girls have different things that in our society, usually the mother provides. It's more of a mother instinct. But then you did this, because I was raised by a single mother, and that for her was hard because she had to be the dad mm-hmm. for me. So she had to go out there and work and do all these things. But for you, it was different. You had to be the mom and the dad together.
Yeah. So I would just keep it simple. You remember this painting or this picture? It shows this lighthouse with this huge wave hitting it. You know, it's this lighthouse in the middle. You've seen something similar.
I think we've had that painting.
So that's what it's like to raise girls. Is it's like this constant battering of emotional stuff going on.
They're probably giggling and rolling their eyes.
And you must be that lighthouse that just stays there and doesn't move. Because what they're doing is they're testing you to see if you actually can handle it. I mean, why should they follow you anywhere if you're not tough enough to make it happen? So yeah, you got to be that lighthouse and let all that stuff come by and just say, now we're going this way and don't bend, because that's the way it is.
And you did it.
Well, you know, so far so good.
These beautiful girls are, you know, doing their own thing. So you said your youngest is in nursing school?
No, oldest is in nursing school. Youngest is just going to be graduating high school shortly.
Oh my God. And the second one, what is she doing?
Psychology. She's in a psychology degree.
I like that. They're all going in healthcare skid.
Well, we're not sure what the youngest is going to do. She's actually probably looking more towards architecture.
Okay. I thought one of them were going to be like, Dad, I want to be like you.
No.
Did you just try to push them, don't do this?
I didn't go either way with that. I just always said, work hard.
I love that.
Find something that you like and work hard at it and then make it happen. And don't slack off.
I like that. I mean, for sure, they got all their perseverance and love for school and whatever they're doing from you.
I hope so. Yeah. I mean, give them some credit too. I mean, they work hard on their own. They made their own stuff happen for sure.
That's amazing. So now that you've been how long have you been a pilot now since you started?
Jeepers. I got my first flying license in 1991. So what are we? That'd be 33 years?
33 years. Wow.
How long have you been alive, Johnny?
I was born 95. 95.
So I've been flying longer than you've been alive. Yeah.
But that's amazing. I wish I was in one of those flights that you were.
We'll have to do that sometime. Now that would make a good video. You guys should let them know if you want to do something. We'll put something like that together.
Listen, I rode a helicopter once and still very scared of heights. That's why I don't look at the window in an aircraft, because I'm I have a phobia of heights. I know, though, that the flight attendants and some pilots know and watches my video because there's so many times going on these flights back and forth. It's so funny because one of the pilots just stopped me. He's like, John, I watch your video. He's like, I'm not a nurse. I'm a pilot, as you can see, but I can relate to some of the stuff that you do.
Absolutely.
And I'm like, how can you guys relate to our stuff? First of all, you've seen some of my videos. Can you relate to it?
Well, sure. Like I was telling you before, we were just talking, what the first thing that I like is your positivity message, right? I mean, we see so much negativity is waiting for you as soon as you open up your phone somewhere. It's just this podcast blasting this person and this politics and this person and this is going wrong here. And it's like, how about we do something that's a little bit fun, a little bit educational, a little bit uplifting? And that's what I kind of see out of your stuff. You know, we have fun with it, of course, and entertaining. But at the same time, the message is one of being positive. And that's why I agreed in the first place when Janelle even told me about this and started looking up. I go, oh, yeah, I get it. I mean, I try to do something similar with my channel.
Exactly. So we'll actually dive deeper than that because actually, you guys, if you don't know, Skid has his own YouTube channel, which his daughter is very proud of. And he doesn't believe me that his daughter thinks he's the coolest father ever. But tell us more about that. So other than, you know, being a pilot, being a dad and all this stuff, you also make videos on the internet and post them in YouTube. How did you got yourself into making videos and posting it on social media?
You know, I remember you telling me your story. It happens incrementally. There's no plan. It just kind of happens all of a sudden. You know, one step leads to the other. So back in the day, obviously, working full time and taking care of young kids, not a lot of time. Have to manage time. So back then, I mean, I always loved cycling. But I did a lot of my cycling then on the stationary trainer because I got to be around with the kiddies and stuff. And so what I used to do is watch videos of people because it was just starting to be able to do that, you know, 2014, 2015-ish. People could take video of their cycling. And I'd watch that as on my stationary trainer. And I said to myself, if I ever get out there, you know, maybe one day I'll take videos. And so it came about, and, you know, kids got older. They could start taking care of themselves. Stuff was going on. And that's when I put together my conversion van and said, hell, I'm just going to go around and visit friends, stay there, and also explore and do cool bike rides. And so I got the videos together and started doing that. And I said, I'll post those because who knows, maybe there's somebody like I was who can watch my videos while they're riding their stationary trainer and give something a little bit back. And then as I'm doing it, I'm going, well, I've got my motorcycle with me. Might as well take some motorcycle videos. Then I got all my workout equipment with me because I take it in the trailer. And I said, you know, doing workouts in the middle of nowhere is kind of cool. We can do that. And I've met some interesting people who do the same thing. And so I started taking those videos as well, and it just kind of grew into the channel. And that's all I do. Like the whole purpose between, or for my channel, which interlaps kind of with yours with the positivity, is just I'm not suggesting anybody do what I do or do it exactly what I do. I'm just saying here's something you can do. So if you apply yourself instead of just kind of sitting at home or, you know, getting on the internet, doing whatever, just if you have something you want to do, make it happen. It doesn't have to be huge, but just do something. And I just like to give an example of something positive that I like doing. And I, you know, I tell you the best part about it, well, other than meeting the cool people, which I throw you in on that because that's part of it, right? Because, you know, if I didn't have the channel, Janelle wouldn't have thought of it. But the best part for me is, that, for example, I'm doing a trip in May down to Albuquerque to see a friend of mine.
Oh, wow.
And I know that I'm going to be doing some workout videos. So I got to be ready. So I've been training like crazy to stay in shape for it because otherwise I can't do the workouts.
That's amazing.
Motivation, right?
That's amazing. And I mean, like I said, I've watched some of your videos and I see how adventurous you are. And you do this alone most of the time, or do you have buddies that you go with?
So I'm in the van alone completely and usually doing everything by myself, but I like to visit friends. What's nice about this having the setup is I've got a lot of long lost friends that I haven't seen in years and sometimes decades just because life gets in the way. Well, now I can go and visit them and live in the van, and instead of being a house guest, which gets tiresome after a while for everybody, I can be a neighbor because I'm just living in the van over there. So I can stay there a month and it works out just fine because you're not in each other's space and you do whatever and then you hang out or whatever. And so that's what I've been doing. So I will see the friends and stuff, and from time to time we'll do something. Like I did a big trip out to the East Coast there last year and was with my buddy Grungy. And so we did some motorcycling together and things like that. But other than that, yeah, I did some cycling by myself and workouts by myself too. So it leaves it very, very open. So it's much more organic. You don't have to do forced activity with somebody. It's just if we feel like doing it, we'll do it. And that's the best way, right?
Good. And so this leads me to think that, are you like an introvert? Do you like having your own space and just doing all of this alone? Or is it just that, you know, you don't want to be forcing people to come along with you, or what is it? Because for me, when I go out, do this kind of like adventurous things and stuff like this, I like being with people because it's, for me, it's more fun. Like, I don't feel like I can drive a van for like 18, 24 hours kind of thing alone.
The trip to Halifax was like 5,000 kilometers.
That's crazy
to me. That's 3,000 miles in freedom units. But so a little half and half, right? So, of course, I wouldn't be talking to all you tens of thousands of people out there, and I know you're watching this, if I wasn't a little bit extroverted. And I like telling my jokes and having fun and being around people and doing stuff. Do I enjoy my alone time? For sure. Does it necessarily drive the way the activity goes? Not necessarily, but the fact of the matter is, if you're going to get in a van and go away for a month, you're probably doing that by yourself. Who else are you doing that with, right? I mean, you know, if I had a partner who was like so into that and was able to do that, well, sure, but that's a really rare circumstance. So I'm not going to let that hold me back from not doing what I want to do. So if I'm going to go do it alone, I'll go do it alone.
That's amazing. So guys, did you took a note of that? He would like a partner who would love to do this kind of things with him.
I know. I said if it happened. I didn't know.
You don't know that one of these listeners could be someone like, God damn, I've been looking for someone to do this kind of trips with me.
Oh, maybe. We'll see.
And the next thing you know, someone's sliding on your DM. Have you ever heard about that, sliding on your DM?
Well, with you, yes. I think you were the first person I ever DM'd on Instagram. So,
Thank you. So Skid slid on my DM. So look out for someone sliding on your DMs.
So if they were smart, though, because remember, 55, Gen X, right? They would look on my YouTube channel.
Okay.
And they would see on there that has my email address, and they'd send me an email because that's going to get to me way fast. First of all, I don't update the Instagram at all, and I hardly ever check it. By far and away, the most I've checked it is coming here with you, Johnny.
After this, you have to put some time on that Instagram. Yeah. And like you said, if you want to, you would. Right? Because, you know, some of these nurses are going to want to reach out to you and get to know you.
Well, remember what we said, Johnny. You know, anything worthwhile is going to take a bit of effort. So you got to give them a bit of effort. You know, you got to see if they're going to actually put
it in. Okay, women, we are gathering information. We listen very carefully.
Of course.
That's why I'm giving them pointers. Things that they can take down and just like, look, he loves this, he do this.
Oh, you're gonna ask me what I like where this is going. All right,
so my that leads to my next question. Are you dating anyone right now?
I am actually not dating anybody right now.
Good for everyone listening right now. Since you're not dating anyone right now, Skid, what is your type of woman? Can you describe it to us?
You know, I thought you might ask this, so I started thinking about that a little bit. So let's start with the basics. She's got to be in shape. Because not only that makes her look good, but that means that she has the right mindset to take care of herself.
Okay.
All right. So
are we talking about in shape, like athletic shape, or just in shape that she's able to do things?
Athletic.
Athletic.
Yeah. So like she doesn't need to bench 200 pounds, but she needs to be athletic.
Cool.
Right. Pleasant disposition.
A pleasant disposition.
So
can you further explain that?
She's a joy to be around.
Good.
Right. Because she smiles. You know, you come in the room and she's happy to see you. That kind of thing. So just being in shape and having a pleasant disposition, that's putting you in like the top 5th percentile right there. So that's all you have to do, ladies, is just be in shape and smile once in a while, and you're going to beat out all your peers.
So unfortunately, a lot of our nurses right now are probably off the charts. We do not smile. We are out of fucking shape. Shit.
So, but the nice thing about being human is you can work on things, right?
Okay.
So you can always get in better shape. You can work on your disposition. We can do these things. We can always make ourselves better. And that's the whole point of life, right? Is we're always striving for something better. And so that's the beginning. But then where I'd go from that is, if you really ask me what I would look for, it's, you know, and we talked about social media and stuff. We live in a very toxic environment. And by a toxic environment, it means that just about every one of our basic needs is ready to be catered to by someone somewhere. It's like, oh, eat this bad food. Oh, consume this social media. For boys, consume the porn. It's all right there. It's all your basic stuff just given to you. And so when I associate with people, friends, and even, you know, let alone a girlfriend, partner, It's like people who are very good at understanding that's there and keeping that stuff at bay with healthy self-discipline. So if you can take care of yourself and keep that negativity away and stay disciplined and focused on the important things in your life, that's the kind of people that I like to hang out with.
That's amazing. So someone that has the same outlook as you are. Good.
Yeah.
Good. And when was the last time you dated someone?
November.
Fresh from the market, you guys. Somebody is back on the market. And would you like to tell us why it didn't work out? Can we go to that? Or was it too...
Great lady. Yeah, a lot of respect for her.
Cool.
Fantastic lady. I would say that I think that the easiest way to describe it is, so a lot of your audience is younger and they probably haven't...
Oh, no.
They remember what it's like to graduate high school, right?
Right.
Okay.
Right.
So graduating high school is a very big time of change, right?
Cool.
So you're not in the high school environment anymore. You might be going to university. You might be going to trade. You might be going overseas. You might be doing something. Everything's about to change in your context. Well... when you are retiring from your job, when your kids are leaving the house, it's a very similar, I'm finding it very similar to finishing high school. All the old context is done. And so there's going to be a new context. What are you going to do? And it's actually, the problem is kind of similar where you're like, and you're leaving high school, you're going, oh my God, what am I going to do? There's so much choice, right? And at the end of the day, you know, like I told my kids, you got to pick something and just go. And maybe it doesn't work, and maybe it doesn't, but at least you get somewhere and then you kind of iterate your way forward.
Right.
And so this is what I'm finding now is like, well, I got this choice for the first time in forever. And you get a little apprehensive because actually having freedom and choice is scary because now if something screws up, it's your fault. You know, if you are in a constrained situation, well, if things are screwed up, it's not your fault. So that's kind of, I won't call it easy, and nobody wants to be in that situation, but mentally it is kind of easy. So when you finally do get that freedom, it's like, okay, what am I going to do? All that to say is this transition, the relationship did not survive the transition.
Okay. So it was a harsh
It was like a high school breakup. She's going that way, I'm going that way, and that was all there was to it.
Okay, so you both just have different like outlooks in life, and you guys thought at the beginning that, you know, it was something that could work out.
Well, and I was like, I wouldn't, at least not anymore, I don't try to go into things with the huge plan. It's like every day is going to happen as every day happens. And I like situations where I'm around with people, not just girlfriends, but friends, because you want to be, not because you have to be. So I didn't have a huge plan. Was I making some plans? Sure. And if those happen to work out. But yeah, I don't try to have the whole thing planned out. What I will do is I try to plan my life out and go, okay, what kind of stuff would I like to have happen? Well, I want to go there in the van. I want to do this. I want to meet these people. I want to do this and want to have that happen. Okay. And I start putting that together. And if some lady wants to come along with that, that's great. But if not, then that's fine too.
Would you ever change how you do things? Because I guess like you've lived most of your life by yourself, though you've dated women and had girlfriends, but still most of the time you were in control of a lot of things in your life. But that also means that if you want a partner, there's going to be a point where either they're going to ride along with what you're doing and how your life is and your lifestyle is, or if you really love this woman, but you guys have such a different like ways of life, one has to adapt or you guys have to compromise. Would you ever do that in a way?
So this is the interesting part about relationships. Right. I mean, you know, you're going back to 10,000 years worth of human interaction here, which is great, you know, because the young people haven't gone through this kind of thing yet. So I like to think of it in terms of incentive. You know, if there's incentives to make things happen, then people will do them. So, for example, you might need to compromise on a certain situation somewhere in order to stay with somebody. Usually when you're younger, the incentives to make that happen is you want to build a life together. So, for example, getting married, having children, this kind of thing. If these become your goals, then, yeah, you're incentivized to do that. You're going to have to make adjustments to make that happen. Not huge ones, because you want to pick the right partner so that it's as congruent as possible, but you're going to have to do something. The interesting thing about being older is those incentives aren't really there anymore. Like a lot of people my age, I find, are doing things more out of fear, where they go, oh, I don't want to be alone, or I don't want to grow old alone, or I don't want to do this. And I'm like, man, you do anything relationship-wise out of fear, you're starting on the wrong foot to start with. It should be out of joy, out of a mutual compassion, out of something, not out of fear. That's the last thing you want to do. So that's a long-winded way of saying, yes, maybe, but it's a lot more difficult now, I think, just because that incentive structure isn't there.
Right. I mean, like, again, at the end of the day, it's, do you date someone younger than you, someone within, like, closer to your age? Like, what is... We're getting more information here, you guys. I'm trying to dig.
I've sampled the buffet. I've dated...
You've sampled the buffet.
I've dated much younger women. I've dated women, or a woman who is slightly older than me even. So, yeah, if it works, it works. It's not so much the age. Yeah.
Again, Skid, like, you are a good-looking lad. So I would say...
Thanks, Johnny.
The female are probably like, yeah, like, I would date this man. Like, yeah, a mature man... Check,
you know,
pilot check.
The funny thing is it's like, you know, and we're joking, but like you think there's probably people in your audience who are going, you know, and not just about me, but are like, you know, how do I meet a guy like this, and how do I meet a girl like that? And so I think the tragedy of our time is that it looks like it's super easy, but it's not. Because you could say, oh, well, I can just go on the Tinder and do all this stuff. But that is not a good way of meeting people. And so I think that there's actually a lot of guys like me out there. I think there's a lot of really great women out there, but they're doing what I'm doing. They're just taking care of their life and doing their stuff. You're never going to see them because they're just nowhere to be found. And that's a real tragedy.
Are you in a dating app?
Not right now. Ever since November, I just, no.
Have you tried?
Absolutely. Oh, I have stories for you, Johnny.
Like, are we talking about Tinder, Bumble?
So, Johnny, I'm old guy, so...
Let's not call you old. Listen, you...
Experienced.
Experienced. I like that.
So, my first encounter with all this, of course, is post-divorce. So, now we're talking, like, 2007, 2008 time frame.
Shit, yeah, we don't got that.
Well, here's the thing, so...
We got MySpace or Yahoo.
Wait for it. Before then, I mean, these people will never believe this, but... You used to put personal ads in the newspaper because there was no internet.
Did you do that?
I responded to a couple way back when I was in like grad school. So we're talking early 90s.
You know what? This is interesting to me. That is so funny.
It's the same dynamic, but that you see now. But it was literally a personal ad in the paper, and you just respond to it through the paper. And then if people wanted to get together, they would.
I feel like I've seen this in a movie.
They used to write songs about it.
Oh, that's crazy.
The whole Pina Colada song. That's where that comes from. Anyway, so when the thing that was going on at that time in 07, now jumping ahead,
okay,
the internet was around, but smartphones weren't around yet. So you couldn't have like Tinder and stuff. But they did have Plenty of Fish. And you look at Plenty of Fish now and it's just a disaster area.
That's the name of it?
That is the name of the dating site.
Plenty of Fish.
Plenty of Fish. So yeah, I know you wouldn't know anything about this. But anyway, it used to be the place to go.
Okay.
Like, because there was no Tinder or anything else. I mean, it's in the same zone as like Lava Life and Match and all those old websites, right? So I tried this thing a few times, you know, and I just couldn't get it. You know, my responses were not optimal. And so I finally decided to go with something that worked. And do you want to know what I did? So I took that picture of me by my F-18 and I put it in the Plenty of Fish app, or it wasn't an app, but the website thing. And you have to give yourself a name.
Okay.
So my name was Captain Superstar. Wait for it. It gets better. No. It gets better. Now.
Skid, you could have done better than Captain Superstar.
No, just wait. Listen, the measure of effectiveness is, does it work or not? Not how it makes you feel. So did this work? Absolutely. But let's get to it. So you not only have like the name, but you have to have a byline. Because you actually, instead of just putting pictures up like you do at Tinder, you actually had to build a profile back then. So
yeah.
So you needed a byline, you know, something. So my byline was, is it cool in here or is it just me? Wait for it. It gets better. So you used to have to put your hobbies on this.
Okay. So what did you put as a hobby?
Flying me. More flying, more me.
God damn.
Because you've heard the joke, how do you tell when you're halfway through a date with a pilot?
Nope.
He'll say, well, that's enough about flying. Let's talk about me.
That is way too fun. If you put that as your bio, sold.
All I'm saying is when I finally did that, done. I had that girlfriend for years.
Wow.
Years.
Wow. Was she younger?
About the same age.
Same age. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. So something clicked. Wow. Plenty of fish. Is it still alive?
It is, but it is awful now. So everything eventually drives to the bottom, right? The market always drives everything to the bottom. Because when Tinder first came out, it was pretty cool too.
For but sure.
Tinder, it is a waste zone now. So that's just the way things go.
But have you ever tried Tinder and Bumble and all stuff? You did?
Oh, yeah.
Who signed you up?
I did.
How did you find out about it?
Well, I'm not dead. I mean, just because I'm experienced doesn't mean that I don't know stuff.
I like this.
So, for example, I have my YouTube channel, right? So I like finding stuff out.
I find stuff out
by doing things, right? For example, my line of merchandise on my Unchained Skid. Which has sold virtually nothing. Although you can go look at there and just have a good laugh. So that's good. I was curious. I saw other people doing merch and said, how do you do that? And then I just dug into it. It's pretty easy, actually. So if I want to find out about something, I'll just go do it. So I'm like, what is this Tinder thing? Oh, you got to do this. Oh, that's irritating. Okay, yeah. Oh, pictures. It's just pictures. Okay.
Okay, so you haven't really dug into Tinder and Bumble. Because actually, you can leave a voicemail in there as your bio.
Well, this is new, right? Tinder back in 2014 was a different story, right?
Yes. Yeah. So if you ever go back, right now, Tinder, Bumble, all of these things are very different. The DMs are going to be wet and wild.
Would you like one more kind of fun story?
Yeah, let's do it.
So Bumble used to have this thing on there that said, 2 truths and a lie.
Oh,
okay. You remember those things?
Yes.
So maybe for your viewing audience, I could give them 3 statements and they could try and guess which one is the one that's wrong or not.
Okay. Are you guys ready? Wherever you're listening right now, at work, at home, while taking care of your laundry, errands, whatever, listen to this 2 Truths and a Lie by Skid and we will figure it out.
Okay.
Let's do it.
Number one, I once performed in front of 750,000 people. All right. So second one, now for Americans, we have this head of state in Canada called the Governor General.
Yes.
Okay. And the Governor General is notionally the king's appointee representative in the country. So it's a very, very important head of state. I once got drunk and partied with the Governor General. Number three, I was once arrested in Albuquerque.
Okay. I know the lie.
Do you want to let them try and figure it out?
I think we all have the same answer, you guys. So let's debunk this together, besties, if you're listening. First of all, he performed 750,000. Thousand? That's a fucking lie right there. Second, he...
Are we past an hour? Can we start swearing now, finally?
Yes, you can start.
Fuck this.
Second... He worked with the RCMP, so there's a high chance and probability that he probably got drunk with the Governor General. That's for sure. He was talking about Albuquerque like 10, 15 minutes ago. He probably did got arrested in Albuquerque. So you guys, I think we all have our 2 truths and 1 lie here. Oh, you know what, guys? We're going to have a comment section down below in Spotify. Make sure that you tell us which one in this 3 things was the lie. So you can slide on his DM if you get it right. Okay? I will be the one putting you guys in the same chat room and you guys can have a conversation right there.
You're a hell of a matchmaker, Johnny.
Hey, you might try plenty of fish, but you don't know plenty of podcast listener.
I have some idea of your audience out there and you're right.
Yep. We got plenty of nurses. You might see plenty of fishes, but we got plenty of burnout nurses. That's a different story there.
Nurses. Anyway.
Okay, I love it. Okay, well, moving on, Skid. We're actually moving on to the part where a bunch of people, random people, have asked you questions.
Okay.
And I'm going to be putting you in the hot seat because you will be answering all these questions. Are you ready?
Let's do it.
First question. Tell us how a day in a pilot's life is.
A pilot's life is preparation, then execution, then debriefing.
So would you say that a lot of times it's unpredictable and you just gotta go through it?
It depends on the nature of the job.
Right.
A lot of airline stuff is more predictable, say, than forest firefighting. But the right. unpredictable nature of the job is that the weather's always different. The runways are always different. Something's always different going on. So you always have to adapt to those circumstances to keep it as safe as possible.
Amazing. So it sounds like a lot to connect with, like, healthcare workers.
Yeah, yeah. Well,
sometimes it's predictable. Sometimes it's not. It depends really what you're doing.
Yeah.
And, you know, you just got to roll with it.
Well, for example, like, if you have a patient come in, you're going to analyze all the different parts of the patient, right? Like, all the different aspects of the patient's what I mean.
Right.
And so that's the similarity is, am I analyzing all the different aspects of the flight?
That's amazing. That's a really good way of explaining it, just because, like, you know, I guess we could relate it to nurses and how we do our things. Next question. What has been your biggest inspiration in this field of work?
Kind of on the jokey side a little bit, but maybe not. You got to remember, like I said, I was born in 68, so I was a little boy in the 70s. And in the 70s, there was this great TV show called The $6 Million Man. And you guys can go look it up, because it's all on YouTube there. But bottom line is, this guy was a jet test pilot, and he crashed, and they replaced his arm and his legs with cyborg parts. And I didn't want to have that happen.
Of course
but
not.
The cool thing about Steve Austin was, is he got to fly jets, and he got to go into space and do all kinds of cool stuff. And I said, that's what I want to do. I want to be like Steve Austin. You know, my dad, too, you know, seeing what he was doing. And then, honestly, as I got to know more and more about stuff, like when I was moving towards being test pilot, which didn't happen, but
right.
close, guys like Chuck Yeager, you know, who did such amazing work, Neil Armstrong.
Wow. I mean, like, I would want to visit space one day. Listen, I'm still flabbergasted about the things that's, like, happening. And, like, did you saw the solar eclipse 2 days ago, I think, or yesterday?
It was yesterday. I was in Edmonton, so it was only partial. And I was busy running around getting ready for this trip, so not as much, no.
No, me neither, because they didn't have it here in Los Angeles. I think it was so partial.
Yeah.
Next question. How do you manage your personal life and work life together?
Okay, so right now, being retired for me, or semi-retired as it is, I still like working. I still want to do stuff. I still want to contribute and make stuff happen. It's mm-hmm. just I get to do it on my own schedule now, which is something you appreciate, right? Because as you're doing your podcasting,
for sure. stuff,
you set it up how you want to. And that kind of freedom is really awesome. So I think what the question is directed to is, like, when you don't have that freedom, how do you make that happen? It is very, very hard, especially taking care of family stuff. Of course, you have to do what you have to do for the job to keep the food on the table. And that's just a no-fail mission. But I would find that the way to make time for the kids and put stuff in place was to plan it like a mission. Like, what I would do every year, I would take a week off of work, okay. but keep the kids in daycare. And why would I do that? It was because I would take one kid out of daycare, and one kid at least one day a year would have me for the whole day for one special day, right? And so, you know, I'd ask them, whatever you want to do, you know, and do all three. And then I'd go do my cycling, right? And then you plan trips too. It's okay, you know, we're so busy, we got to do this. Well, we can go, we don't have to do the biggest trip. We don't have to go to Disneyland, but we can go like 50 miles to where this beach is, and we can hang out there for the day. But instead of just kind of like, you know, just dreaming about it, you actually have to go plan it like a mission. We are going to do it this day. We're going to go at this time. We're going to assemble this stuff. We're going to do it like that. And so I guess the only way that I've found to balance these things out is to prioritize the stuff that doesn't get prioritized, like the family stuff, and put it up there as a priority, and then it gets done.
You have a different kind of like experience and situation that you needed to work it out, compared to, you know, some people who have help and, you know, partners who can do this kind of things with them. But you plan it out. And again, you know, you've raised this beautiful ladies on your own, and that's a hard thing to do.
Well, even now, I mean, you know as well as I do, you know, we were talking about economy and the way things are going. I mean, you got two-parent families are working their asses off as well.
For sure.
And so it's not easy anywhere. And, you know, like I say to them, they're going to have the same problem. So they have to work together to establish a priority.
That's it. It's like knowing what you should prioritize first, or the things that you wish you could prioritize and put them really in priority over the things that you've been giving your time and energy to.
Absolutely.
Amazing. Next question. Any advice to someone trying to become a pilot?
I would, I guess, to start with, try it. Because the first thing I did was, I actually went as far as getting my private pilot license. You don't necessarily have to do that. Go flying. Go get a familiarization flight. Go see what it's like to be in the air. Maybe you get horribly airsick, in which case that's probably not the career for you. But maybe you really, really love it and you fall in love with it and it's something you want to do and you're good at it. But you should probably try it a little bit first before you make a huge commitment. And then when you are deciding what to do, if you really want to do something, whether it's nursing, flying, whatever, you got to give it your all. So commit and go and see what happens. And it's like I say, there will be uncomfortable times because nothing worthwhile is easy and it always will have a chance of failure.
That's it.
So I would say be ready for that. And then if anybody wants to hit me up about like specifics about the industry later on, because there's specifics about the nursing industry, you talk to these folks and give them great advice about things that, hey, you know, things that aren't always as they seem. And, you know, these are the kind of things you have to watch out for.
Right.
Similar stuff pilot wise, just won't bore the general audience with that. But for people who are really looking into it, I would say that just as a general thing, and you've run into this kind of thing too with nursing, is that be careful how the institutions or the businesses or the militaries or whatever will always download risk as far as it can go to the end operator. So it ends up being, well, the one nurse sitting there now has to prescribe the meds that they weren't supposed to do before. Well, now this pilot is being told, well, we got to push the weather and go do this. Well, you should be getting backup from above and you're not always going to get it. So be ready to make really, really big decisions.
Going back to our questions, what are the qualifications to become a pilot in US or Canada?
So it depends what part of it, whether you're going to be civilian pilot or military pilot. Cool. So military is going to have some pretty high standards. Vision to start with. Vision's going to have to be perfect or at least corrected to perfect nowadays.
Shoot. So like as a pilot, you need a 20/20 vision. Is that it?
Yeah.
But can you wear prescription glasses?
Not to get in. But nowadays, they will let you get laser eye surgery to do it. So you need that. You have to be in really good health. And then there's going to be, I mean, I can't speak to the USAF, but in terms of Canadian forces, there's going to be a whole bunch of tests to go through. Not only flying ability, but mental ability, multitasking, all kinds of stuff to do. On the civilian side of things, the very first thing you're going to have to do is pass a medical, which isn't as stringent as the military one. So, for example, you don't have to have the same vision standard, but they will take, you know, ECG of your heart, the whole nine yards to make sure that you're good. And then after that, once you're past the medical, then it's just, you know, can you actually pass your flight tests?
Okay, so it's a lot of preparation. It's a lot of, like, qualification.
Well, I mean,
like,
the thing
it makes sense, the qualification.
The thing is, there's a definite studying component. There's a knowledge component. But then there's just ability. Like, you still have to be able to fly.
Yeah, as you get into it. Next question. How was your first experience flying?
I remember when I was getting my private pilot's license. Remember I told you I got that before I did anything else? My very first solo was very cool. The very first time you are alone in an airplane and you are responsible for your own fate up there is wonderful. I really, really love that solo.
Wonderful. Next question. Is the rumors true that pilots have different girlfriends in every single airport they visit?
It depends on the pilot.
Okay, how about skin? Have you had different girlfriends in different stations that you've been?
Well, I never really did commercial flying like that. Remember, mm-hmm. I was always coming back home. So not in that particular context.
Do you know any pilots who have different girlfriends in different?
Yes.
So it's true.
Sometimes.
Okay. Damn. Are you guys that looking for?
Well, it's the same as any other profession. As you know, some guys no, but some guys sure. Yeah, absolutely.
Have you ever been in a medical emergency while flying?
I do have a tiny little funny story.
Okay, spill it.
When I was flying the F-18, there was this kid who was just waiting for his training, so he was with us on the squadron, and he'd done some really good stuff. So they gave him what's called an incentive flight. He got to fly in the back seat with me as I was flying the F-18 around. And unfortunately, he picked a mission that we're doing air to ground. So we're doing pulling a lot of G and rolling around all over the place.
Right.
And at one point, he's going, Skid, can you just fly straight and level for a bit? Yeah, sure. Oh, he's just throwing up and throwing up and throwing up.
Oh, shit.
And, you know, that's a vulnerable place to be, and that's for sure. But this guy, man, like I say, if you do something really bad, but you have a snappy comeback, it makes up for a lot. So this kid, he put the bag away, got his mask back on, and he went, sir, do you have a mint? Nice recovery.
I like that.
Very nice recovery.
He's like, let me just pull myself together with a mint.
Never give up.
Never
give up. And have a snappy recovery.
We'll get this quicker, guys, to the part that you guys are excited about. What do you do when you need to pee during flight?
Oh.
That's so funny to ask us a question, but I think it's valid.
So if you're in a two-crew aircraft, you just get up and use the lab. So co-pilot can fly, and I'll go back and use the laboratory. Done. That's easy. All right. The problem is when you're flying single pilot. So
that's the fucking question.
So I used to fly the PC-12, which is a kind of like a small commuter airplane, you know, 6-7 passengers kind of thing. And there, first of all, there is no lab in it. And secondly, I'm a single pilot, so I can't leave the controls ever. It can be flying on autopilot, but I can't get up. So generally, when I was flying passengers around, none of the legs were longer than 2 hours. So that usually wasn't a problem anyway. And that also meant that first thing in the morning, I had to not have my morning coffee to make sure that I could make those first legs.
I could never do that.
I would just have a little bit, right? Now, there were times that we had to do surveillance flights, and surveillance flights would last 5-6 hours up there. And what we do is we just take an old oil bottle and pee in the bottle.
That I've done that many times.
How can you not? You got to do something, right? So
I've emptied, like, you know, water bottles just to make it out there. Next question. Tell us the craziest experience you've ever had as a pilot.
The most shocked I ever was, because okay, I've come close to dying in airplanes, but always been able to see it and kind of known it and avoid it kind of thing. There was one time I was flying a PC-12 out of a northern reservation, because the RCMP, we go back in and out. And I was coming out at night in cloudy weather, and it was snowing, and it was really awful. So I went to take off on runway 32, and I made all my radio calls and all that stuff. And as I climb and I put my gear up, and I'm in clouds already, and I'm just kind of doing my thing on my departure, I hear a radio call of an incoming Dash 8 who says he's on final on the opposing runway.
Holy shit.
So he's right there somewhere. I can't see him. It's dark. It's night. It's cloud. He's right there. We have this thing in the airplane called a TCAS, which shows where the other airplanes are kind of around you. And I look down, and it's right on me. So I'm like, we're going to
die.
So I pull back and turn left to just get off of the course that he's on. Like, he's coming down this way, so I just try and pull, and I just wait
and see how,
and we're still breathing 5 seconds later. So I'm like, okay, I have no idea how close that was, but that was really close.
Holy crap. Yeah, that is crazy. Next question. Have you ever needed to do an emergency landing where you didn't think you'd make it? I think that is my biggest fear, emergency landing out of nowhere. I was like, whenever I'm in the Atlantic, it's like, please put us on a fucking mountain or, I don't know, icy fucking places, but don't put me in water. Water is my biggest fear.
Yeah, I hear you on that. I haven't had one that was so critical that resulted in a divert. I've had things where I need to get on the ground right away.
So how do you guys choose where to land?
So if you're flying, first of all, if you're flying a single engine airplane like the PC-12 was, you almost always just are always looking for where that's going to be as you're flying along. If you're flying a twin engine or multi-engine airplane, you don't think about that as much. You think about more, what are you going to do if one of the engines stops, and you deal with that.
Shit.
And that's what you brief. You have to brief it, because when you have the briefing in your mind, that's what you'll follow if it really does happen. And you have to think about it ahead of time, because it's when it's happening, it's too late to think about. You think about it before it happens, and then you brief, and then you take off. And if it works out, great. If it doesn't, it doesn't. The best safety device in any aircraft is a well-trained crew.
That is true. That is true. 100%. Just like in the hospital.
Mm-hmm.
Just like in the hospital.
Absolutely.
Next question. Do phone really mess up plane navigation system, or is that a lie we've agreed to believe?
The answer is more complicated. So the thing is, the easiest way to describe it is they don't know for sure.
Okay.
Right? Because you've got a lot of frequencies doing a lot of stuff. What they will say is this is more of a legal thing. This is a liability thing, not an actual physics thing. So if the lawyers can't say for sure that it doesn't interfere, then whoever's conducting the operation of the flight, like the air carrier stuff like that, if they don't tell you to put your phone off when they don't know for sure if the phone's going to cause interference, they can be sued. So that's why everybody's got to turn their phone off, because we're not sure from a legal point of view.
So you guys, even though it's, we don't fully know exactly if it does affect it, again, just like in nursing, you know, you're taking this medication, we don't know if you're going to get a side effect. You're still going to take that medication because that medication is going to help you get better. And you don't look at the side effect of it or the negative of it. Again, it's weighing the pros and the cons. And sometimes you just got to believe it. Next thing, what's the wildest thing you've ever done as a pilot?
Up in British Columbia in Canada, there's a mountain called Mount Waddington, which has got this huge glacier on it. And so the top of the mountain is about 10,000 feet, and it goes all the way down to sea level with this glacier.
Okay.
And what the jet pilots will do if they're flying like a T-Bird or Tudors, they'll go to the top of the mountain, and they'll just zoom down the glacier at 200 feet off, and they call it the toboggan run, right? So down you go into it. But there's one airplane, so a Tudor, that's the same one the snowbirds fly, can't go up. But the F-18 can, because it's got enough power to go up the glacier. So what I've done is come from the bottom of the glacier at 200 feet off the deck, off the ice, in like a 10-15 degree climb, because you're following the glacier up to top. And at the top, there's like this V peak. And so I rolled inverted. I didn't go through the peak. I was just kind of on top of it. But I pulled about 6 or 7 Gs as I'm watching the peak go over as I go. And that was super fun. So it kind of reminded me a little bit of that latest Top Gun movie where he rolls inverted to pull the gun.
Yes.
It was that.
So
was
you've seen Top Gun Maverick?
Of course.
Seeing every single pilot in there. I think the nurses confirm how hot pilots are.
That was just the exact right amount of cheese in that movie. I mean, there was a lot of cheese, but it was exactly right. So it was good.
That's it. Next question. Explain turbulence, and should we be shit scared of it and cry on the stranger beside us? Okay, so turbulence to you actually scares the shit out of me, because sometimes it's okay, you know, like, but sometimes you really get shaken. It's almost like a shaken baby syndrome. Like you get shaken and you just don't know what's going to happen.
So a couple things. The shaking that's going to happen to you physiologically is nothing compared to what's going to happen to the wings. So I wouldn't worry about your brain pan rattling around or anything else in your body, because before any damage would ever happen there, the wings would break off. And that's a much, much worse problem. Now, under any kind of like light or moderate turbulence, and moderate turbulence is pretty shaky, nothing's going to happen to the airplane. And you start getting into severe turbulence, that can be a problem. But that usually is usually that is predictable. Also, thunderstorms. Just don't fly through a thunderstorm, period. That kind of turbulence to worry about. So generally, to answer the person's question, you generally don't have to worry about turbulence.
That's a reassurance for a lot of us flying. We're good, you guys. The turbulence, ignore it. Just sleep through it. We're getting closer to the good part in here. Can you call in sick as a pilot? If yes, how? And if not, why not?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. There are very, very stringent rules on what you're allowed to do as a pilot health-wise. And if there's anything even kind of wrong with you, you have a moral and ethical and legal obligation to not fly. So you call into whatever the dispatch. I mean, if it's airlines, you call into airline dispatch. If it's, you know, military, you talk to ops or whatever. But yeah, if you can't fly, you can't fly.
Good. That's good to know. Because even us nurses, like, we cannot be coming. I mean, that's not true. Actually, we've come into fucking work medicated most of the time because it's just harsh. But yeah, it makes sense for a pilot to not, you know, to be in a good 125% health condition. Now, we're done with this very, very formal questions.
Oh, boy. Here we go.
We wanna, you know, leave that apart. And we've got all our answers. We were educated. Now we want to be
entertained
and yeah, get all this heat coming out. First question.
Oh boy.
Have you been part of the Mile High Club?
No. I've flown mostly single pilot airplanes. It's hard to do that way, but no. But I will say.
You will say what?
That every date that I've ever taken a girl flying on has had 100% conversion rate.
Damn.
Yeah, 100% is solid gold guaranteed every time.
Every single time. Well, it's not just about the Mile High Club. It might be about the person too. You know, skid.
No, just saying, you don't necessarily take them flying 5,280 feet high. Just taking them flying will.
Yeah. We'll get.
Yep.
Damn. Okay. Next question. Have you ever had sex with a flight attendant? If so, why?
First of all, I've never flown with flight attendants. So now, but on the other hand, who knows?
Would you?
If she was cute enough, sure.
Okay.
I would say that I would definitely date a flight attendant.
Okay.
It's just most flight attendants wouldn't date a pilot.
they're too
smart for that.
Yeah, thanks to the flight attendant.
They're around pilots too much.
Yep, they're probably like, no, fuck no.
No way.
No, we're not doing
zero.
That.
Zero.
Have you ever had sex wearing your uniform as a pilot?
Yes.
There you go. Why? What's with the wearing your...
They love the flight suit, man.
Yep. Like, have you ever, like, role play with it?
Don't have to. I am the role.
Okay. You are the role. Okay.
Keep in mind that flight suits have two-way zippers. You can zip this way, but you can also zip up this way, right? Just saying.
Good. Because, you know, I don't think they would need the zipper. They just break it.
Well, yeah.
Lose it. Like, make it happen type of thing. Next question. Do you ever get horny in a long flight? If so, what do you do?
I don't fly long enough to that becomes an issue anymore. Back in the day, maybe, but, you know.
What do you mean, Skid? Because one thing I can assure you is the older you get, the hornier you get.
All I say is that my patience is longer now, so I can wait.
Okay. Mm-hmm. What's your favorite sex position? Cockpit way?
They're all good. they're so, I mean, you know, it's so context dependent. I like to say I like a variety.
What's variety? We want to know.
You want the specifics.
We're very specific.
I can't give you all my trade secrets.
Well, you can definitely give us a basic of something.
Well, let's say you start simple and work your way up.
Okay.
Not always, though. So sometimes, you know, sometimes a little improvisation is required. So depending on the urgency of the situation, you might not even be horizontal. You might be vertical up against the wall. Who knows? Just depends on the situation.
Okay. Heading back to the question.
Right.
I think one last raunchy question is, how good are you in bed as
me,
a pilot?
Me, oh, well, okay. Like I say... I think you'd have to, you know, you can't answer that for yourself. You'd have to ask, you know, those who have participated with me. I haven't received any complaints.
You haven't received any complaints.
That's good. Then again, pilots are very narcissistic, so they probably wouldn't listen anyway. But I think so far so good. It's.
So what's your biggest compliment you've received in bed?
Right. One time I was told by the lady in question that up until she had met me, she was a man virgin. In other words, she hadn't had sex with a proper man. She felt that I was the first time that she was manly enough for her.
Okay.
So it's just, that's nice to hear.
So you must have given her some...
I just gave her the standard.
Standard?
Yeah. Well,
the nurses are asking, what's the standard?
The skid standard. The skid standard is a pretty high standard.
Okay. And lastly, Skin, I think a lot of people are feeling a bit hot in here, a bit hot on the seat right now. All right. Lastly, what is something you want to say to the people listening and to those who aspire to be a pilot one day?
Oh, yeah. Just say that you have to understand, just like nurses or any other high stress occupation, there's always going to be not enough money, not enough personnel, not enough stuff to do things, and stuff that still needs to get done. And that means that the organization is going to download the responsibility and the risk to the lowest common denominator, which is the operator, which is, in this case, the nurse sitting there or the pilot running the mission. The weather could be bad. The icing could be bad. Stuff could be bad. Oh, we got to get this done. Just be very careful, both nurses, pilots, and anyone else, is be very careful accepting risk on behalf of the organization that's going to come back and get you. Be very, very careful of what you accept. No, I think you said it best, you know your boundaries and enforce them.
Exactly. And like, don't break your values and your beliefs just because you want to make someone at work happy. Again, you do this job because you want to do this job and this job makes you happy, and you come to the job to do your job and not to, you know, impress someone else.
Yeah, for sure.
Learn to say no. The biggest is learn to say no, because your no is your sign of like, I have boundaries and I'm not letting anyone destroy that.
Now, that being said, mission focus is important, but it has to be done the right way. You know, sometimes the best way isn't just a direct no. Sometimes the best way is, I need this, this, and this, and this to get the mission done, and I don't have them. So the way you want me to do it right now, I can't do it, but I could do it with this. But don't just accept that minimum solution, because you're going to get hurt.
Amazing. And I think, you know, we've learned so much from you, Skid, not just as a pilot, but also as a person. And I think this is such a good episode because, again, you've also taught us a lot of wisdom. And this wisdom are things that we could use, you know, as we go day by day or at work or anywhere else we go. So thank you again so much for, you know, coming into the pod and being a guest and being here with us. And I'm pretty sure everyone that's listening right now are appreciating this. So again, thank you guys so much for listening to this episode of the podcast. But before you go, do me a quick favor and make sure that you follow Skid on his YouTube channel, which is called Unchained Skid. And also, he will be working up his Instagram account, which is going to also be Unchained Skid. And we will see a lot more of him. And I told him to not put, we don't want to see no airplanes. We want to see his airplane. I mean, his pictures and more. Right? So again, if you want to talk to Skid, if you want to have a conversation with him, see what he does and all his videos, go follow him. And he also has some merch that they can support.
Yeah, we got mugs with my face on it.
There you go, Unchained Skid.
And if you know, that's a little over the top. We got your favorite thing. I have a caffeine mug and a chocolate mug.
Look at that.
Oh yeah,
you got everything. You gotta check it out. Go see, and again, ask all your questions to Skid. All you have to do is reach out to him. The email address is on the YouTube channel, you guys. And again, before you leave though, make sure that you follow us in Apple and Spotify podcast. Download this episode, share it, tag me on I Beg Your Pardon on Instagram, and also you can tag Skid and Unchained Skid on Instagram. And again, I will see you guys again for another week of episode of your favorite podcast, I Beg Your Pardon. And again, Bessie, thank you so much for coming with us and listening. So I will see you again next week. Thank you. Goodbye.